Students, it's April the 12th, Sunday. This is video 10. It's the second video for the week of August the 13th to August the 19th. Material covered in this video will be on the next test. There'll be one more video for this week, and that'll be video 11. Last time we were on chapter 13, and I've gotten various emails, and I appreciate it, asking me if I'm okay, and I'm fine, and some people really like the humor that I inject into the videos, and I got a lot of emails about that, so I'll try to put more of my humor into the videos as well. Anyway, chapter 13, Amphibians. Here you can see a picture from chapter 13. Last time we talked about the fish were the first vertebrates to appear in the rock record, starting with the astracoderms. And we talked about the lobe fin fish evolving to the amphibians. Amphibians are the first vertebrates to invade the land. They're the first vertebrates to have lungs instead of gills. These amphibians are nothing like the amphibians that you and I are familiar with today. I'm sure growing up in Tennessee, Kentucky, or wherever you grew up, you've seen little newts and salamanders and frogs and toads. They're usually not too big, though I've heard that there are those mud puppies up in Scott County where they get a bit larger, but these were much larger. These are 6 feet, 10 feet long, quadrupeds. Quadrupeds means an animal that walks on four legs. It's called a quadruped. A dog is a quadruped. Here you can see these ichthyostega, quite large amphibians. Another thing you need to know about amphibians is that when we talk about vertebrates, they do reproduce sexually. And we talked a lot about that when we talked about Darwin's theory of evolution, that sexual reproduction results in diversity. And that gives an advantage in the battle for survival. It should be mentioned that both fish and amphibians use external fertilization. External fertilization is different than what mammals do, which is internal fertilization. And external fertilization has to do with, if you've ever seen the way toads and frogs reproduce, what they do is, after it rains, the females will lay eggs in the little puddles of water, and the males can sense that, a change in the chemistry of the water, and they will ejaculate onto these clutches of gelatinous eggs, and some of them will hatch and produce tadpoles. It's another thing different about amphibians is they sometimes go through what we call a tadpole stage, which is an intermediate stage between infancy and adulthood. That's different than reptiles and mammals who do, and birds and dinosaurs. They don't go through a tadpole stage. Amphibians don't have shells on the outside of their eggs. That's another thing to remember. They don't have what we call a they don't have a type of egg that where there's a yolk or there's a placenta or some food source when they're in the egg. They don't have a waste sac within their egg, so they have to hatch relatively quickly. That's why they're much more immature than reptiles or mammals or birds when they hatch. And that's why, being so immature, sometimes they have to go through this intermediate stage called being like a tadpole stage. Here you can see another amphibian. It has a triangular shaped head. And you can see that it has sharp teeth. These are actually predators, the top predators of the day, the top predators on the land in the middle part of the Paleozoic, the amphibians. Another one here. This is called Doloxama. And I don't know if you're familiar with amphibians, but if you've ever had a pet as an amphibian, when I was a young boy, back in the 70s, they used to sell newts in stores. What is a newt? Well, they don't sell them at pet stores anymore. I don't think it's legal. Back in the 70s, they used to sell these things. And they look like this. Have you ever seen anything that looks like that? These are called newts. Well, these are typical of amphibians. Sometimes they go through a tadpole stage, an immature stage. They always have to keep their skin moist. Amphibians are still attached to the water. Even though they've left the water, they have to return back to the water to lay their gelatinous eggs. They also have to keep their skin moist. I used to have these when I was a kid in a terrarium, and sometimes they'd escape from the terrarium. My mother would get really angry because she'd find them all dried up under the sofa. They have to keep their skin moist. Amphibians must keep their skin moist. They must lay their eggs in water. They lay gelatinous eggs, and they practice external fertilization. They don't have an amniote egg. What is an amniote egg? Well, when you were in your mother's womb, you were in an amniote egg. And reptiles lay, and birds and dinosaurs lay amniote eggs. Amniote eggs are self-contained units that allow for the egg to be hatched on land. Amphibians don't have that. So reptiles are the first vertebrates to develop the amniote egg. Here you can see the embryo. The embryo is contained with an amniotic cavity that protects the embryo. There is a food source called the yolk sac. And there is an allantois. The allantois is a waste sac. So the embryo can eject its waste into the allantois. This is a self-contained unit, allowing for the embryo to grow much more developed within the amniote egg than in an amphibian. So reptiles, mammals, birds, dinosaurs, mammals don't have to go through a tadpole stage. They grow quite mature within their mother's womb. Have you ever, I'm sure you have. You've eaten hard-boiled and soft-boiled eggs in the morning. You notice that little film inside of the shell? Well, that is another thing that we have for reptiles, reptile eggs. You have a little film called the chorion inside of the shell, and that is, it's a vapor barrier, keeping the moisture in. So when a reptile lays its eggs, it lays these amniotic eggs, and it's got a shell on the outside. Now, we, as humans, we also grow up in our mother's womb in an amniotic egg. There's a chamber protecting the embryo. Instead of having a yolk sac, we have a placenta. We don't have a shell, but it's a self-contained unit. The first vertebrates to develop the amniotic egg are the reptiles. Please don't forget that. And reptiles are also the first mammals to practice internal fertilization. Internal fertilization means that the male must insert its organ into the female reproductive organ, And that's called internal fertilization. And when we were talking about evolution, we were talking about how whoever has what it takes to survive the battle for survival is going to pass on their genetic information. And that also works its way in when you talk about sperm and egg. Through sexual reproduction, the sperm that is most vigorous and most able to survive the journey during sexual reproduction is the one that gets to impregnate the egg. So that has a strong effect on biological evolution, so that males who have more vigorous sperm, more sperm, are more likely to pass on their genetic information. So every sperm is sacred, just like Monty Python. Here's my humor clip for the day. It's a song by Monty Python from the 1970s. It's called Every Sperm is Sacred.
Well, let me put it like this.
There are Jews in the world. There are Buddhists. There are Hindus and Mormons and them. There are those that follow Mohammed's butt. I've never been one of them. I'm a Roman Catholic and have been since before I was born. And the one thing they say about Catholics is they'll take you as soon as you're warm. You don't have to be a six-footer. You don't have to have a great brain. You don't have to have any clothes on. You're a Catholic the moment that came. Because every sperm is sacred. Every sperm is great. If a sperm is wasted, God gets quite irate.
Every sperm is sacred. Every sperm is great. If a sperm is wasted, God gets quite irate. Let the heathen spill theirs on the dusty ground. To make them pay for each sperm that can't be found. Every sperm is wanted. Every sperm is good. Every sperm is needed in your neighborhood.
Hindu, Taoist, Mormon, spill theirs just anywhere. But God loves those who treat their semen with more care.
Every sperm is sacred. Every sperm is great.
If a sperm is wasted, God gets quite irate.
Every sperm is sacred.
Every sperm is good.
Every sperm is sacred, every sperm is good.
thought you could use some humor there. And if you're Catholic, please don't take offense. It's just Monty Python. It's kind of funny when we're stuck here in our houses all day. Anyway, here we go. So the first vertebrates to appear are the fish, and the fish evolved to the amphibians, and the amphibians evolved to the reptiles, who were the first ones to do internal fertilization. So the reptiles appeared third. The complete story is first the fish arrived. They evolved to make the amphibians. The amphibians evolved into the first reptiles. The reptiles evolved to the first mammals. The mammals later on would evolve in the Mesozoic to the dinosaurs. And the last vertebrates are the birds, who evolved from the dinosaurs in the Mesozoic era during the Jurassic period. This is what the early reptiles look like, prototherids, and these are lizard-like reptiles. Reptiles, besides doing internal fertilization, how are they different than amphibians? Well, they don't go through a tadpole stage. They usually have larger brains. They have amniotic eggs. Amniotic eggs, as we mentioned before, have a shell and a chorion to keep the moisture in, so that the reptiles don't have to return to the water to lay their eggs. They can conquer the drier parts of the planet. And that's their big advantage over the amphibians, is that they have that, and they also have skin that doesn't have to be kept moist. So you find desert tortoises, you find snakes in the desert. In dry parts of the planet. So the reptiles were real important because they led directly to the conquering of the land by animals. And these primitive reptiles appeared first during the Mississippian period, but some people think the Devonian period, but they definitely appeared after the amphibians. They led to the plesiosaurs. We're going to take a look at them, which led to the therapsids. The therapsids are the first mammals, or at least they're the first type of animal that had mammalian characteristics. They also had reptilian characteristics. These would lead to the mammals, the therapsids. We're going to talk a lot about them. Mammals came after the reptiles. The reptiles also led to thecondodians. Thecondodians walked on two legs. Animals that walk on two legs are called bipedal animals. Bipedal, meaning they walk on two legs. Humans are bipeds. Dogs are quadrupeds. Now, the reason why that's important is because the thecondodians would lead to the first dinosaurs in the Mesozoic era. The first dinosaurs were bipeds. They walked on two legs. This is a real important diagram to remember for the test. Remember what these look like. First type of reptile we're going to talk about is called the plesiosaurs. They lived during the Pennsylvanian and Permian. They didn't survive the Paleozoic. It's kind of annoying when you watch Jurassic Park and other Hollywood films, because they depict these plesiosaurs as dinosaurs. They're not dinosaurs. These are not dinosaurs. Why? Well, we're going to learn that dinosaurs have two holes behind their skull. Dinosaurs have two holes behind their eye socket, I should say. And that's what we call a diapsid skull. These plesiosaurs did not have two holes behind their eye socket. Here's Tyrannosaurus rex with two holes behind its eye socket. Instead, it had only one. And so we know that it's not a dinosaur. Also, other features of it are not dinosaur-like. So we know they were not dinosaurs, they're reptiles. In Jurassic Park, they have these being dinosaurs. They're not dinosaurs. They did not exist during the Mesozoic era. They died out at the end of the Paleozoic. They're quadrupeds. They're huge, 10, 15 feet long. And what stands out to you when you see this animal? Well, for most people, what is it? It is this huge sail on its back. That's how you're going to remember for its for the test. Also know it has a large skull, meaning it has a large brain, meaning it's a predator. Predators usually have large skulls. Look at its teeth. Sharp, made for killing. This is a predator. 10, 15 feet long with large sails on their back. What do you think these large sails were for? Well, there's three hypotheses. Hypothesis number one is that you know how lizards, when they're on a rock and they're both wanting the same piece of real estate to absorb the sunlight? Reptiles are what we call cold-blooded animals. They need that heat or they will die. So they rely on the sun to keep warm. So that's why lizards bask out in the sun. We are warm-blooded animals. We generate our own heat, so we don't need to do that. Well, reptiles need to do that. So maybe these things orientated these sails. There's bone here, and there's a skin flap here to absorb heat. That's hypothesis number one. What else do you think it could be used for? Well, another thing that lizards do, and they're not really smart compared to mammals. Their brain size is much smaller. Is sometimes they flush color into different parts of their body to scare other reptiles. So maybe they flushed the blood vessels went through these sails. Maybe they flushed color into these sails to scare away other large reptiles. One of the most popular ideas is that the males had enormous sails compared to the females. Maybe that this was used in sexual attraction, which is part of Darwin's theory of evolution. They developed this to attract females. For example, if you were a male with a huge, enormous sail, maybe you could attract females better. On the other hand, if you had a tiny, itsy-bitsy, little microscopic, small sail, do you think you're going to get any? I'm sorry. Do you think maybe you couldn't attract females as well if you had a small sail? Anyway, that's an idea. Here's what the pelicosaurs look like with their sails. Don't forget, they're not dinosaurs. They existed before the dinosaurs. The reptiles led to the therapsids, the first mammals. And mammals are different than reptiles. They practice internal fertilization, just like the reptiles. But the difference is they're warm-blooded. They don't need to bask out in the sun or they'll freeze. So they can occupy the colder parts of the planet. That's their huge advantage. And they have fur or hair to keep them warm. Another way of keeping warm in colder climates. Another thing you want to remember about mammals is they have a four-chambered heart versus a reptilian three-chambered heart. And since we can pump more blood, mammals can pump more blood, we can have bigger brains. We can also maintain our body temperature. Some other advantages that mammals have over reptiles is mammary glands. The fact that females can produce milk allows for the offspring to have a source of nutrition after it comes out of the womb. So the baby can grow more mature and stronger and more resistant to various diseases and viruses. And a big advantage, mother's milk. The mothering instinct is huge as well. Only mammals have the mothering instinct, which, well, some birds do too, but reptiles don't have the mothering instinct. If you ever look at snakes or turtles or crocodiles, they'll lay a clutch of eggs. After they hatch, sometimes they'll eat their own young. The mothering instinct gives the infant a much higher chance of survival. And according to evolution, if you have a higher chance of survival, you have a higher chance of passing on your DNA, giving mammals an advantage. The fathering instinct does exist. I love my children very much, and I'm sure your father probably loved you very much. And if you have a father in your life, you know life is, if you have a good father in your life, then life is a lot easier. And you do see the mammal, the father instinct in the mammal kingdom. But it's only found on, for the more intelligent, more evolved mammals, usually the primates, monkeys, apes, and humans. But the most we find it is in humans. Now we're going to talk a little bit about plants. Plants evolved to conquer the land. And you probably remember that they do photosynthesis. They are producers. You need to remember that as well. There are four kinds of plants. Let me see. I'm going to write them for you here. There are four kinds of plants. Four kinds of plants. The first one, they are, the first, I'm going to write them in order in which they appeared on planet Earth. The first plants to appear are the seedless, non-vascular plants. Then came the seedless, vascular plants. Then came the gymnosperms. And the last to appear on planet Earth are the angiosperms, who now dominate the planet. So there's a list there, ladies and gentlemen. Four kinds of plants. We need to remember that for the test. The first plants to appear on planet Earth are the seedless non-vascular plants, followed by the seedless vascular plants, and then your plants with seeds, which are gymnosperms and angiosperms. Let's take a look at the seedless non-vascular plants first. As the name implies, these do not have seeds. That means they reproduce by using spores. Spores, the sperm and egg come together as a spore. Once the spore is released, the seed and the egg are already together. With a seed, the sperm and the egg have to come together. That's the difference. These are very primitive plants, usually very small. Think of things like moss. That's a seedless non-vascular plant. You ever go out into your yard and see these lichens growing on trees like this? Those are seedless non-vascular plants. These are plants that they're the most primitive of all plants. Here's the first seedless non-vascular plant. It has one spore on here, one spore on here. The water goes through the plant. Notice that it only has one tiny root going into the ground. Seedless non-vascular plants only have a simple tube going into the ground or into rotting wood or into rock that's decomposing. And so they have a very primitive root system. They have no seeds, no leaves, definitely no flowers or fruits or nuts. It's just a simple stem. And there's no vascular cells either with a seedless non-vascular plant. What's a vascular cell? Vascular cells are specialized cells in plants that move food and water around. So they don't have any vascular cells, so they can't grow very big. They're very tiny. These are the first plants to appear on a planet. These are the seedless non-vascular plants. Most plants today have vascular cells. Let's go to the second group of plants to appear in the rock record are the seedless vascular plants. And there's many different kinds, but the most common today, the one you need to remember for the test, are ferns. Fern plants have leaves. They have more extensive root systems. Why? Because they have vascular cells, specialized cells that move food and water around. But they still have the primitive trait of having these spores. Look in the bottom of fern leaves. You ever see those little things there? That's each one of those is sperm and egg together. And those are called spores on the undersides of the leaves. These are seedless vascular plants. They appeared next. All plants with seeds are either angiosperms or gymnosperms. The gymnosperms appeared next on the planet. In the Paleozoic, in the very later part of the Paleozoic, gymnosperms are trees. The ones that you need to remember, okay, most common that you're going to see around here are pine trees. They are gymnosperms. So when we were little kids, maybe you, at least I did up in New Jersey, we collected pine cones. All those beautiful pine cones that you see here are from pine trees. These are from gymnosperms reproduce in this way. They have cones. Horsetails are also gymnosperms. And these are ovaries. I know people don't like to think about plants as being sexual organisms, but they are. These are ovaries which contained eggs. Now let's look at the male organ. The male organ is this. So these are testes. They have sperm in them. What happens to form a seed is the pollen, which is sperm, gets blown from the male organs into the air. And the eggs from the ovaries, which are these pine tree cones, are released into the air as well. When they meet in the air, they make a germinated seed. They make a gymnosperm seed. They make an embryo. And that seed is going to make a new plant. That's different than spores, where the sperm and egg were together at the beginning. They had to meet. So for a gymnosperm to reproduce, it requires for the plants to be in close proximity to one another. If you have a pine tree and there's not another one around for miles away, it's not going to get to reproduce. That's why pine trees come in clusters. The last type of plant you need to know are the angiosperms. And they did not appear on the planet until the Mesozoic era, which is the next couple chapters. So I'm not going to talk about them as much, but I will tell you that angiosperms are the first plants to have to use the animal kingdom to spread sperm and egg. And the way they do that is through flowers, fruits, and nuts. They attract animals to spread their seed. and that's why they dominate the planet. It's very ingenious. So their seed could be spread a lot further out, greater distances. Grasses, all of your grasses are angiosperms as well. A gymnosperm seed reproduces just like you see here. Sperm and egg come together. The pollen is sperm. The egg comes from the female cone, making a seed. These are the first plants that use seeds instead of spores for reproduction. These appeared at the end of the Paleozoic era. During the Pennsylvanian, which the Brits called the late Carboniferous, we had lots and lots of coal swamps. Don't forget that most of the world's coal, including Tennessee coal, Kentucky coal, West Virginia coal, was formed in the Pennsylvanian period of the Paleozoic era. That's why we have so much coal around here, because we have so much, it's the remains of these trees that died a long time ago in Tennessee. 290 to 310 million years ago, during the Pennsylvanian period. Here you can see what it looked like during the Pennsylvanian. You can see some reptile. Oh, this is an amphibian. But by the later part of the Paleozoic, we still had large amphibians, a lot of them, but they were starting to be replaced by reptiles like the plesiosaurs. That's the end of chapter 13, and the next video will be chapter 14. I believe this is going to be called video number 11, and then you'll have one more video 12, and that'll be the lecture for this week. I hope everyone's staying safe, and I'll see you in the next video.